You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon, and welcome to Health Science 100 for the Young Scholars Program. And we are here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. I'm glad you are with me. I'm Robin Sinks. I am the instructor for the course. And today is our 12th session. So at the conclusion of today's broadcast, there will only be two more broadcasts, and we'll conclude our semester course. Okay, we have gone through a great deal of material this semester to give you some insight into your own health and to hopefully encourage you to take on some of those health practices. Last week, we focused our conversation on the reproductive system. We looked at structure and function of male and female sex organs. We looked at the changes in sexual functioning across the lifespan. We looked at various ways that human sexuality is expressed and guidelines for safe, responsible sexual behavior. We also took a look at conception and pregnancy and childbirth, the changes that a woman goes through, the stages of fetal development. We talked a little bit about good prenatal care and then ended up with the process of labor and delivery. So that was a lot of information. I hope you were able to look through that again and review it. And I hope you had a chance to really use that information to think about your own behaviors and maybe encourage others to take on those safe behaviors as well. Today we are going to look at the issue of contraception, so preventing conception. We're going to look at how contraceptives work, how to interpret some of the information on effectiveness, risk, and benefit. We'll take a look at the popular contraceptive devices, methods. We'll be discussing their advantages, their disadvantages, and their effectiveness rates. We hope that in the end, at that time when you need to, you will be able to choose a method of contraception that is based on your needs and keeping in mind the safety and effectiveness of that method. We're going to close out today's broadcast with a look at the legal status of abortion in the United States and a little bit about methods of abortion that are available. So again, this is one of those chapters with a lot of information. You're going to need to review it, read it several times, take good notes on it so that all that information gets in. And I certainly would appreciate hearing from any of you today during the broadcast. I'd like to know what key information you learned from this chapter. You can certainly call in your response to me, or you can email it, and that email will be sent over here to me in the studio. So, I certainly encourage you to do so. There are only a few more opportunities for you to earn any extra credit in this class, and that is one of the ways you can do that. So again, what key information did you learn from the chapter? Okay, and while you are thinking about your response, we'll go ahead and get started. People have had an interest in managing fertility, preventing unwanted pregnancies, for a very long, long time. That that process of managing your fertility, managing the pregnancies during your life cycle, is called birth control. The concept, of course, through all of this is to prevent conception. And that's what we reviewed last week. Blocking conception by the use of a device, a substance, or a method are referred to as contraception. And again, that's against conception. In addition to preventing pregnancy, some contraceptives do protect against or at least reduce the risk of sexually transmitted diseases, which we will be talking about next week. So let's go ahead and look at the principles of contraception. There are many different approaches to contraception. There are a variety of barrier methods that work by physically blocking the sperm from reaching the egg. Those include diaphragms, condoms, and a few other methods based on that principle. Another approach to contraception are hormonal methods. This is anything from oral contraception, what we all refer to as the birth control pill, or different applications of those hormones that alter the biochemistry of a woman's body. It may prevent ovulation, that release of the egg. It may produce changes in the reproductive system that make it more difficult for the sperm to reach the egg if ovulation does occur. And then there are a few natural methods of contraception that are based on the fact that the egg and the sperm have to be present at the same time for fertilization to occur. So if we can alter calendars, we may be able to prevent that from happening. And then lastly, there are surgical methods, male and female sterilization. These more or less permanently prevent the transport of sperm or eggs to the site of conception. Each of these contraceptive methods has advantages and disadvantages that make them appropriate for some individuals, maybe not so appropriate for others. Some may be the best choice at one period in our lives, and then maybe not such a great choice at another period in our lives. So we have a lot of options. Factors that affect the choice of the method include its rate of effectiveness, its convenience, its cost, the fact whether it's reversible or not, the side effects and risks involved in using that method, and then the degree to which that method may also protect against STDs, sexually transmitted diseases. So let's look at contraceptive effectiveness. It's partly determined by the reliability of the method itself. That failure rate, as if it were used exactly as directed each and every time, or what we call perfect use. Effectiveness is also determined by characteristics of the user, including the fertility of that individual, frequency of intercourse, and how consistently and correctly the method is used. We call that typical use. That's the failure rate based on studies that directly measure the percentage of women experiencing an unintended pregnancy in the first year of that contraceptive use. So for example, a 9% failure rate for oral contraceptives means 9 out of 100 typical users will become pregnant in the first year on that oral contraceptive. The failure rate is likely to be much lower for women who consistently and carefully follow those instructions, and is even higher for those who are frequently careless. The perfect rate for oral contraceptives is 0.3%. So we have to keep in mind there's typical effectiveness rate and there's perfect failure rate. Another method of effectiveness is when we look at the continuation rate, or the percentage of people who continue to use a method over a specified period of time. It's important because many unintended pregnancies occur within the period when we're stopping the use of one contraceptive and beginning the use of another. So we actually increase the likelihood of unintended pregnancies when we switch contraceptives methods frequently. The other thing we have to remember is that many of these contraceptives methods are reversible contraception. So that means for those who plan to eventually have children or want to keep their options open for later in life. So the reversible contraceptives we look at are oral contraceptives and the hormonal variations of that. So we're talking about the pill, the patch, the ring, implants, and injectables. IUD devices, intrauterine devices, are also reversible contraception. Male and female condoms, diaphragms, cervical caps, contraceptive sponges, and spermicides. Abstinence, fertility awareness, and withdrawal are also classified as reversible. So we can use any of these kinds of methods for a period of time and then stop use if we are looking to have children, or looking to plan our families. So those are some things that we need to keep in mind as we go through all of these various types of contraception. Okay, so I'm going to take a few comments at this point. I see some of you have been sending in, so let's go ahead. First one up is Sophia. Glad you are here. Key information that Sophia learned about from the chapter are the different contraceptives for women and how high the disadvantages and the side effects are for women to use protection, and oftentimes they're more risky for the woman. Unlike men, there are more advantages of wearing a condom and preventing HIV and STDs. So yes, there are advantages and disadvantages to each type. Most of the contraceptives are focused on use by the female, so she's carrying the weight of many of those risks. And then male, at this point, we're really looking at condom use and condoms being effective for STDs and pregnancy prevention. So I'm glad you realized all of that, and I hope you learned something out of the chapter. All right, Cecilia, thank you for joining us. Cecilia says, instead of just choosing whichever contraceptive method, individuals should keep in mind health risk, comfort levels, STD risk, costs, as well as religious beliefs. Okay, good considerations. Thanks, Cecilia. And Jennifer Lynn, I didn't know that forms of birth control originated so long ago. I thought it was fairly new to society. I also didn't know that abortion had to be done during a certain time of pregnancy. All right, glad you learned some things in the chapter, and we will talk about the abortion issue toward the end of our broadcast today. Thanks, Jennifer Lynn. Jasmine, glad you are here. Key information that I learned in this chapter was how contraceptives work, how to interpret the information about the contraceptive method's effectiveness, risks, and benefits. I also discovered the history and current legal status of abortion in the United States, along with the types of abortion available. Okay, so you looks like you've met some of the objectives out of the chapter. Glad you were able to share that. And Milan, glad you are here. From this chapter, I learned that there were different contraceptives and how each works. I understand the effectiveness, risks, and benefits of them, along with there being both advantages and disadvantages. Okay. Very good. Thank you all for your comments. Okay, well, any of the rest of you who would like to share with us what you learned, go ahead and get that in. And I'm going to go ahead and we're going to start by looking at the hormonal methods of birth control. And the first one up is what we call oral contraceptives, most commonly known as the pill. these contraceptives prevent ovulation by mimicking the hormonal activity of the corpus luteum. So they trick the body into believing that it's already pregnant so that it will not continue to ovulate. They may also thicken the cervical mucus, alter the rate of ovum or egg transport, and they may prevent implantation or the changing of the uterine lining, the lining of the uterus, in the unlikely event that a fertilized ovum does reach that area. I have a really quick video clip for us on how does the birth control pill work and how safe is it.
The birth control pill is safe and super simple. You swallow one tiny pill every day, and that's it. You're protected from pregnancy. But you have to take it every day. So use an alarm or app to help you remember. And the pill doesn't prevent the spread of STDs. So use condoms along with the pill to protect yourself from both pregnancy and STDs. Like other medications, the pill has possible side effects, but they usually go away in the first few months. It has lots of benefits too. The pill can clear up acne, ease cramps, and make your periods lighter and more regular. Want to get on the pill? Your nearest Planned Parenthood Health Center can hook you up.
Okay, so the most common type of pill is what's called the combination pill. It basically has estrogen and progestin in it. Typically, you take one pill every 21 days, then you go off the pill, or you take a placebo pill that contains no hormones for the 7 days. And it's during that 7 days that the process of menstruation takes place. There are some varying schedules, so if you find yourself interested in oral contraceptives, you just need to ask your healthcare provider. Typically, when a woman begins using the pill, there does need to be a backup method of contraception use at least the first week, and many people say use the first month. So very many women who are starting the pill also use condoms at the same time, as at least that first month, to increase the effectiveness for preventing pregnancies. Certainly using the condom with the pill will help reduce the risk of both pregnancy and STDs. You did hear about a few of the advantages mentioned in that video clip. It is simple to use. It doesn't hinder spontaneity, and it does have some medical advantages. Decreased incidence of benign breast disease, iron deficiency anemia, ectopic pregnancy, colon and rectal cancer, and endometrial and ovarian cancer. So there are some distinct advantages to that. The disadvantages to using oral contraceptives, the pill, is that they do not protect against STDs. So it is strongly recommended that condom use accompany the use of the pill. Typically, there are very few side effects that women experience. Sometimes, especially in the beginning, there may be a little bit of nausea and breast tenderness. Those are those symptoms of pregnancy. Remember, the pill is tricking the body into believing it is pregnant, so it's going to have some of those symptoms. Some of you may have heard that oral contraceptives cause you to gain weight. That was true with the earlier versions of the pill long ago, but the current low-dose pills typically do not have that issue. Birth control pills are not recommended for women with a history of blood clots or heart disease, and smoking while using the birth control pill is highly discouraged, because it does increase the risk of blood clots, heart disease, and stroke. Okay, so now can we come to the effectiveness of the pill? Taken as directed, the failure rate is 0.3%. Really effective. Among the average users, the typical first-year failure rate is 9%, 9 out of 100. The average continuation rate for oral contraception is 67% after the first year. So 2/3 of the women who start the pill continue it after that first year. So it's a lot of individuals find it's a very stable type of contraceptive to use. Okay, so oral contraceptives, the pill, are based on the ingestion of these hormones. But we can also get those hormones in some other ways. So we have the contraceptive skin patch. This often referred to as orthoevra. It's about a 2-inch square patch. It slowly releases an estrogen and a progestin into the bloodstream through the skin. It prevents pregnancy in the same way as the oral contraceptives. What you do is you wear a patch for a week, then you replace it with another patch. So you wear patches for 3 weeks, and then the fourth week you wear no patch. That is when menstruation takes place. Let's take another look at a video describing the birth control patch.
Are you looking to prevent pregnancy, but you don't want to think about your birth control every day? Well, the OrthoEvra patch is one of the great options you might want to try. It's effective, easy to use, and best of all, you only have to deal with birth control once a week. Now, I know what you might be thinking. How does this band-aid looking square prevent you from getting pregnant? It's simple. It works pretty much like the pill. The patch has hormones in it. They are absorbed through your skin and prevent your body from releasing an egg. And they thicken the mucus of your cervix to make it harder for sperm to enter your uterus. The hormones can also make your periods lighter and easier to deal with. So what do you have to do? Well, the patch is worn on your skin for a week. You can put it on your torso, stomach, upper arm, or even your butt. Just not your breasts. Every week you replace it with a new patch. On the fourth week, you skip a patch and have your period. The next month, it's the same thing. Patch, 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 no patch, repeat. Simple. You can wear the patch in the shower, in the pool, at the gym. As long as it stays stuck on you, it's going to be highly effective. Fewer than 1 out of 100 women will get pregnant each year if they're using it right. That goes up to about 8 out of 100 women if they don't always use it right. The patch doesn't protect against sexually transmitted infections. Use condoms if you're concerned about preventing STDs. And like other medications, the patch may have some side effects, and it's only available with a prescription. If you're interested in learning more about this method, check out the info on PlannedParenthood.org.
Okay, so very much she addressed the advantages, the disadvantages, and the effectiveness of the patch. The compliance with the patch is a little bit higher than with the pill because you're only having to deal with changing it once a week versus taking the pill every day. So that's another option. There is another hormonal method called the vaginal contraception ring. And it's a 2-inch ring that releases these hormones, prevents pregnancy in the same way as the pill does. The ring is placed in the vagina, remains there for 3 weeks, then it's removed for that week so that menstruation can take place. Let's take a look at the video on the birth control ring.
The birth control ring is a safe and convenient way to prevent pregnancy. You just put a small ring in your vagina once a month. The ring has the same hormones as most birth control pills. The ring has possible side effects, but they usually go away in a few months. It has lots of benefits too, like easing cramps and making your period lighter and more regular. It's super important to change your ring on time, or it won't work as well. You can use a calendar or an app to help you remember. The birth control ring doesn't prevent the spread of STDs, so use a condom along with the ring to help protect yourself. Want to get the birth control ring? Your nearest Planned Parenthood Health Center is here to help.
Okay, so now you've noticed I'm using video clips from Planned Parenthood. Please also note that while they are saying at the end of each of these video clips that they are available at Planned Parenthood, and they are, you obviously can secure contraception from a variety of other healthcare providers, including your family doctor, your GYN doctor, or a local clinic. It's just that Planned Parenthood has some great short video clips on each of these, so you're going to hear that ending every time. Okay, so that's the contraception ring. Now let's look at contraceptive implants. These are placed under the skin and again release a small dose of progestin over time. This device is effective for a period of 3 years and considered to be one of the most effective ways of contraception. The implant is best suited for women who want to have continuous, highly effective, and long-term protection against pregnancy. Let's watch that video clip on the implant.
The birth control implant is one of the most effective kinds of birth control you can get. It's a tiny matchstick-shaped rod that releases the hormone progestin to prevent pregnancy. A doctor inserts the implant under the skin in your upper arm, and that's it. You're protected from pregnancy for up to 3 years. The implant is super convenient and mistake-proof. You get it and forget it. A doctor can remove your implant anytime you want, and your ability to get pregnant quickly returns. The implant has possible side effects, but they usually go away in a few months. It has benefits too, like easing period cramps. The implant doesn't prevent the spread of STDs, so use a condom along with the implant to help protect yourself. Want to get the implant? Your nearest Planned Parenthood Health Center is here.
All right. The implant does not contain estrogen, so therefore there's a lower risk of some of the side effects associated with the oral contraceptives, such as the blood clots and the other cardiovascular complications. So for many women, this is a great choice. Hormonal contraceptives are also available to women through injectables. So the injectable contraception we often refer to as Depo-Provera, or short Depo, and it is usually injected every 12 weeks. So instead of daily like the pill, weekly like the patch, this one you only have to deal with every 12 weeks. Let's take a look at the video clip on Depo.
The birth control shot is safe and convenient. One little shot every 3 months gives you great pregnancy protection. That means you only have to think about birth control 4 times a year. The shot uses the hormone progestin to prevent pregnancy, but it doesn't stop the spread of STDs, so use a condom along with the shot to help protect yourself. Like other medications, the birth control shot has possible side effects, but they usually go away in a few months. It also has plenty of benefits, like making your periods lighter, or even making your period stop altogether while you're on it. The shot is private. Only you and your doctor need to know you're using it. And it's super effective, as long as you get your shot on time, every time. Want to get the birth control shot? In yours.
All right. Okay, so that is the range of hormonal contraception that is currently available. And you will notice in each of those video clips, it reiterated the point that while highly effective in preventing pregnancy, they do nothing to prevent the spread of sexually transmitted diseases. So they do require the use of condoms in addition. Okay, so let's switch over now and look at some of the other forms of contraception. And so we're going to start out taking a look at the intrauterine devices, or what we call IUDs. There are typically two types of them. Paragard is a copper device that provides protection up to 10 years, and Mirena, which is effective for up to 5 years. We have another video clip.
IUD stands for intrauterine device, and it's one of the most effective kinds of birth control you can get. A doctor inserts a little IUD into your uterus, and then you're protected from pregnancy for years. IUDs are super convenient and mistake-proof. You get it and forget it. Your IUD can be removed anytime you want, and your ability to get pregnant quickly returns. But IUDs don't prevent the spread of STDs, so use condoms along with the IUD to help protect yourself. There are a few kinds of IUDs. The Paragard IUD is hormone-free. It uses copper to prevent pregnancy and lasts for up to 12 years. The copper IUD also works really well as emergency contraception. It can prevent pregnancy if inserted up to 5 days after unprotected sex. Hormonal IUDs like Mirena, Skyla, and Laletta use a hormone called progestin to prevent pregnancy. They last 3 to 5 years, depending on which one you get. The IUD has possible side effects, but they usually go away after a few months. They have lots of benefits too. Hormonal IUDs can ease cramps and make your periods lighter, or even stop them completely. Want to get an IUD? Your nearest Planned Parenthood Health Center is here to help.
All right, sorry about the technical glitch there. All right, one thing I just want to point out, in addition to what was presented in the video clip, they did say that the hormonal IUDs may reduce flow and cramping during a period. However, the copper IUD may actually increase that cramping. So just a fine point to consider if you are thinking about using an IUD. Okay, so we've taken a look at several devices, hormonal and otherwise. But now let's take a look at some of the barrier methods of contraception. And we'll start out by looking at the male condom. Male condoms are typically made of latex, though there are some alternatives to latex for those who are allergic to it. Condom sales, we've seen a real increase in the use of, the purchasing of condoms, primarily because they are the only method that provides substantial protection against the HIV infection and other STDs, in addition to reducing the risk of pregnancy. And there is certainly a push to remind couples that when thinking about preventing pregnancy and using oral contraceptions, you have to use both. Several years back, it was, oh, use either or. Now we're looking at, yes, use both. There are several advantages to condom use. Easy to purchase, available without a prescription or any kind of medical supervision. Oftentimes, you can find condoms for free in your healthcare provider, local clinics. They really do not have any side effects other than for those people who are allergic to latex. You just have to be very aware of what it is you are purchasing. Condoms are made of lambskin. They are available, but those do not prevent the passage of the HIV virus and other disease-causing organisms. So that is not a choice if you are looking to reduce your risk of STDs. And except for abstinence, not engaging in any sexual activity, correct and consistent use of latex male condom offers the most reliable protection against the transmission of HIV and pregnancy. There are some disadvantages. Some folks complain that it diminishes sensation, may interfere with some of the spontaneity. Some folks may consider those serious disadvantages. Others may not think it's such a big deal. Many are available pre-lubricated, so that increases comfort and cessation, and they are less likely to break. Effectiveness rates vary considerably. Perfect use, the first year failure rate is about 2%. Typical use is about 18%. And that is mainly due to the fact that they may be poorly fitting condoms, there may be insufficient lubrication, which increases the risk of breakage, and there may be instances where they've been improperly stored. You need to keep them out of the heat. So in your wallet or in your glove box is not the place to keep them. And also there is an expiration date on each condom package. So you do not want to use it past that date. When you buy them, you have a long time to use them. They do not have a short shelf life. So let's take a look at a video clip on how to put on a condom.
Using a latex condom isn't exactly rocket science. I mean, just open the package and put it on, right? Well, sure, but there are actually some things you can do to make condoms more effective at preventing pregnancy and sexually transmitted infections. First of all, condoms can get old and weak after a couple of years, but every condom package has an expiration date. If it's past expiration date, use a newer condom. The package should be sealed so that when you squeeze it, you can feel a little air bubble. If the outside is sticky, damaged, or torn, it could mean that the condom is damaged. That's no good. Open the package gently with your fingers. No scissors or a sharp object that could poke a hole through the latex. Next, you want to pinch the tip of the condom. This gets rid of any air bubble that could cause the condom to break. Before the condom touches the penis, make sure it will roll down correctly. If you put it on the wrong way, it won't roll down easily. Roll down the condom to the base of the penis. Smooth out any air bubbles and add lube. Now you're ready for intercourse. You don't need my help for that. After sex, hold the condom against the base of the penis while pulling out. A lot of guys will lose their erection pretty soon after ejaculating. If you wait too long, the penis will get soft and the condom could roll off or semen could spill out. Holding the condom against the penis while pulling out prevents that from happening. Take the condom off away from your partner. Tie it close and you're done. Congratulations, you just prevented a pregnancy, a sexually transmitted infection, or both. Let's talk lubrication. Some condoms come lubricated, some don't. Some people like extra lubrication. Lubrication is a good thing, but make sure it's the right kind. Oil-based lubricants weaken the latex, making it more likely for the condom to break. So always use a water or silicone-based lube. Not sure if your lube is condom safe? Check out the package or read the ingredient list. Allergic to latex? Use a non-latex condom. So let's review. Expiration date. Check the package. Open gently. Pinch the tip. Roll correctly. Hold the base. Tie it off. No oil-based lube. I know it sounds like a lot, but if you don't have a lot of experience, you can always practice on yourself ahead of time. Don't have a penis? I'm sure you can find something around the house that will work. Condoms are available for free at many Planned Parenthood health centers. To find the one near you, visit.
Okay, so again, a lot of folks think, condom use, easy. But there are some steps because you do need to ensure that the condom is placed appropriately, and that will increase effectiveness. The other thing I want to reiterate from that video clip is avoid all oil-based lubricants because that actually destroys the material itself, causing leakage. So pay particular attention if you decide to use male condoms. There is also a female condom. It is an alternative to the male condom, not as well known, not as readily available, but certainly an option for any of us. So take a look at the video clip on female condoms.
If you're concerned about preventing STDs but don't want to use an ordinary condom, you might want to try one of these. It's called a female condom. And while it looks a little strange, it's great because it gives you control of preventing pregnancy and reducing the risk of sexually transmitted infections. The female condom is a plastic pouch with two rings, one at each end. The inner ring is squeezed and inserted into the vagina before sex. The outer ring stays outside the vagina and covers part of the vulva. After sex, just remove it and throw it away. The female condom works by collecting semen when a man ejaculates, comes. This keeps sperm from entering the vagina. No sperm, no pregnancy. In fact, less than 5 out of 100 women will get pregnant each year if they use a female condom correctly every time they have sex. That goes up to about 20 out of 100 women if they don't always use it the right way. It can be used for vaginal sex or inserted into the anus to reduce the risk of STDs during anal sex. There are a lot of other benefits to using the female condom. There are no side effects, no prescriptions, no trips to the doctor. Except for the latex condom, it can also be used with almost any other method of birth control. If you'd like.
Okay, so good to know. Next time you are out and about, you might want to check and see about the availability of female condoms in your neighborhood. There is another barrier method that I want to briefly address, and that is, there are a couple, diaphragms and cervical caps. These require fitting because anatomically each woman is a little different. So you do have to actually go to your healthcare provider prior to obtaining one of these. So our next video clip, diaphragms and cervical caps.
Are you looking for birth control that doesn't have the hormonal side effects that can come with a method like the pill or the shot? Do you want something that's not going to get in the way of sex? Well, you might want to try a barrier method of birth control like the diaphragm or the cervical cap. Diaphragms and caps, and the spermicide used with them, form a physical and chemical barrier around your cervix, which is the entrance to your uterus. This prevents sperm from reaching an egg. To use a diaphragm or cervical cap, you start by adding a little of the spermicide, and then squeeze the edges together and gently nudge the cap or diaphragm into your vagina so that it covers your cervix. If you're not sure where your cervix is, don't worry. The healthcare provider who prescribes your diaphragm or cap will show you how to get it in, where to place it, how to take it out, and answer any questions you might have. Another thing to know is that you can insert a diaphragm or cap several hours before sex, but you must leave it there for at least 6 hours after. Once removed, you can wash it and use it over and over again. How effective are they? Well, out of 100 women using the diaphragm in a year, anywhere from 6 to 16 will get pregnant. For the cap, the range is from 14 to 29. That's because the cap is less effective for women who've been pregnant or given birth. By the way, neither of these methods protect against sexually transmitted infections, so always use condoms with them if you're concerned about STDs. If you're interested in learning...
Okay, so again, talk with your healthcare provider if you are interested in that particular form of contraception. And then the last one I want to address before break are the vaginal spermicides. Those can be used with or without a diaphragm. There are foams, creams, jellies. They're placed deep in the vagina, no more than 60 minutes or 1 hour before having intercourse. And then additional applications of the spermicide need to be made if there is additional acts of sex. Failure rate by itself is about 28%. So it's recommended that you use spermicidals with other forms of contraception. Okay, we have gone fast and furious through a lot of different types of contraception. I see that several of you have have emailed in and are sharing that you've learned about protecting yourself when engaging in sexual activities, preventing unwanted pregnancies, and the effectiveness, etc. So thank you for those comments. I'm probably not going to get to each and every one today, but those are sent to me, so I will give you extra credit for those. Okay, so at this point, let's all take a quick stretch break, get a drink of water, something to eat, and join me back here in 5 minutes. See you in five.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills. Thank you.
My name is Obi Wogboy, and I'm currently a junior at California State University Dominguez Hills. The reason I came to this school is for the great environment, the small class sizes, and the amazing sociology program.
Many of our brothers feel like they're a part of a family, whether it's the culture, color of the skin, or just being comfortable with other men. The bond keeps growing, and the brotherhood keeps strengthening itself through those means. The Male Success Alliance at Cal State Dominguez Hills is creating a genuine brotherhood.
It does not force you to be anything. It does not require you to be a certain type of student.
We're here emotionally, physically, and anytime a brother needs anything, we're going to be there.
A lot of times, men of color aren't seen as professional, or you don't even see them in professional settings. So the Male Success Alliance is trying to get our men ready within their undergrad to be in that professional setting because they are the professional. The manner that the program is doing this is through the concentration of being there for our brothers. The practical way of doing that is, you know, redefining and strengthening the brotherhood, you know, within the campus and through the workshops and different events that we have. The suit is that signal that we're trying to create. You know, that whole changing the narrative is coming through the suit. When a man's able to be clean, they feel good. It gives this confidence and it oozes out of the guys.
Watching Dr. Franklin and Matt Smith, you know, walk around in these nice suits, it's like, hey, I want to be like that. I want to be him one day. I want to be able to wear that nice suit.
And you see it the results are better academics, more social, a better social life. And a lot of guys just want to be a part of the program because of it.
The Male Success Alliance found me in a very interesting time place, trying to balance classes and my home life. I started to really fail in many ways. I found MSA on my verge of not being a student anymore. Meeting the actual student body president of the Male Success Alliance, I met him and it was like, nah, brother, you are my brother, and anything you need from me, just let me know.
And that's what MSA is built on. How does each one teach one, and how do we bring our brothers along with us? And that's why MSA sets that legacy in terms of, it's not just about CSU Dominguez Hills, it's this region, it's this state, and it's the nation, and these young men are going to change all of them.
My name is Alex Guerrero, and I'm a Toro.
My name is James Harris, and I'm a Toro.
I'm Jordan Sylvester, and I'm a Toro.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back to Health Science 100, and we've spent the first part of today's broadcast looking at a variety of contraceptive methods and devices, and so now what I want to look at are what many people refer to as natural methods. We're talking about abstinence, fertility awareness, and withdrawal. When we think about these, we recognize that there are millions of individuals in the world who do not use any of the contraceptive methods that we've talked about in that first part of the broadcast, either because of religious conviction, cultural prohibitions, poverty, lack of information about them, or the supplies. So if they are using any kind of birth control, planning their family, they are more likely to use these three. So the first is abstinence, and that is the decision not to engage in sexual intercourse for a chosen period of time, and it's been practiced forever. It is 100% effective in preventing pregnancy and STDs. Let's take a look at video clip on abstinence and outer course. You'll learn what that is.
Abstinence means not having sex, right? But what is sex? An intercourse? And what the heck is outer course? Well, people define sex, abstinence, and outer course in different ways. For some people, abstinence means not doing any kind of fooling around. No oral sex, vaginal sex, anal sex, nothing. They're abstaining from it all. Not only does this type of abstinence do a great job of preventing pregnancy, it's 100% effective, it also guarantees you won't get a sexually transmitted infection. For some other people, abstinence means not having vaginal intercourse. They do the other stuff, just not the thing that can lead to a pregnancy. All that other stuff is what we mean by outer course. Outer course is sex play without the penetration. It's like intercourse without the inner... you get it. Kissing, touching, grinding, massage, masturbation, sex talk, all of that can be lumped into what's called outer course. Outer course is also a great method of birth control. As long as no sperm get in the vagina, there's no risk of pregnancy. And if you avoid vaginal, anal, and oral sex, you reduce your risk for sexually transmitted infections as well. Like all methods of birth control, abstinence and outer course are more effective the longer and better you use them. They require determination, self-control, trust, and good communication. It also helps to know about other ways to protect yourself from unintended pregnancy and STDs, just in case you decide to have intercourse. If you'd like to learn more about outer course and abstinence...
Okay, so a good choice for lots of individuals, and when then you do decide to engage in sexual activity, you have lots of information about all kinds of contraceptives. Another one of the natural methods is fertility awareness. Women who practice this fertility awareness-based method abstain from intercourse during that fertile phase of their cycle. Recent studies show that even in women who have regular menstrual cycles, it is possible to become pregnant at any time during the cycle. So this one is not as effective. Let's take a look at the video clip that goes into a little greater detail on this one.
Are you looking for birth control that doesn't have any side effects, is inexpensive, and helps you understand your body's cycles? Fertility awareness methods prevent pregnancy by helping you figure out the days of your cycle when you're most likely to get pregnant. If you avoid unprotected vaginal intercourse or use an additional method on all of these unsafe days, you're not likely to get pregnant. But keep in mind that predicting safe days takes some effort. There can be 12 or more unsafe days in a month, depending on which fertility awareness method you use. And the trick, of course, is figuring out when you're about to ovulate. If you have regular periods, never shorter than 26 days and never longer than 32 days, you can track your safe days with cycle beads or on a calendar. Charting your body temperature or the changes in your cervical mucus also help you identify safe days. Some women do all three just to be safe. You don't need to visit your healthcare provider to start any of these methods, but it is a good idea to learn as much as possible about how to make them work for you. How well do they work? Research shows that 2 to 25 out of every 100 couples who uses fertility methods each year will have a pregnancy, depending on which methods they use and how well they use them. Since there's no medication to take, there are no side effects, and you don't need much of anything except maybe a calendar or a thermometer. These methods don't prevent sexually transmitted infections, so use condoms if you're concerned about STDs. If you're
Okay, so a lot to consider, a lot to manage with that one. And then the last type of this natural kind of contraception is what's called withdrawal. I have another video clip on this one as well. Let's take a look at it.
Accidents happen. Maybe you mess up your birth control or forget to use a condom. But since it can take several days for pregnancy to happen after sex, there's still something you can do. Emergency contraception is a safe way to prevent pregnancy up to 5 days after unprotected sex. It mainly works by stopping sperm from meeting with an egg. There are two options for emergency contraception, the copper IUD or the morning after pill. Getting a copper IUD inserted within 5 days of unprotected sex is the most effective type of emergency contraception. It works as well if you get it inserted on day 5 as it does on day 1. And as a bonus, it keeps giving you super effective pregnancy protection for up to 12 years, or until you have it removed. But sometimes it's hard to get an appointment for an IUD on such short notice, so call your local Planned Parenthood Health Center or doctor as soon as possible. The morning after pill is not the same thing as the abortion pill. It won't end an existing pregnancy. There are two kinds of morning after pills. Ella is the most effective kind of morning after pill. You can take Ella up to 5 days after unprotected sex, and it works as well on day 5 as it does on day 1. You need a prescription from a Planned Parenthood Health Center or your doctor to get Ella. Plan B and other generic pills like it are the next best option for emergency contraception. They're available without a prescription from most drugstores and pharmacies. You can be any gender, any age, and walk in and buy it without ID. You can take Plan B up to 5 days after unprotected sex, but the sooner you take it, the better it works. It's most effective when taken within 3 days after unprotected sex. Morning after pills really lower your chances of getting pregnant, but they don't work as well as using regular birth control. So it's best to find a regular method of birth control and save the morning after pill for emergencies. Sometimes insurance covers emergency contraception. If you're worried about cost, Planned Parenthood can help. Check out PlannedParenthood.org for more information on emergency contraception.
Okay, my apologies. I neglected to give our production staff that last video clip on withdrawal. So before we talk about emergency contraception, let's just go back to withdrawal. The failure rate on withdrawal is about 22% for the first year. Typically, this is what's often referred to as pulling out. The difficulty here is that men who are less experienced with sexual intercourse and withdrawal may have some difficulty foretelling at what point ejaculation might be occurring. So that leads to some of those higher failure rates. And of course, withdrawal, meaning that there is no condom there, does not protect against STDs. So that's just a little bit on withdrawal. My apologies, you didn't get to see the video on that one. But you did get to see the next video, and that was on emergency contraception. And so I hope that you realize that this is not a regular form of contraception. It is an emergency contraception of when a condom breaks or when you have unplanned, unprotected sex. Sometimes it is called the morning after pill. And it does not mean the same thing as the abortion pill. It does not interrupt an established pregnancy. Effectiveness-wise, if taken within 24 hours of that unprotected intercourse, emergency contraception may prevent as many as 95% of expected pregnancies. They certainly are more effective the sooner you can get to them, as the video stated. Your textbook does state that a prescription is required for those individuals under 17 wanting to access the over-the-counter emergency contraception. That actually is no longer true. The textbook was written in 2013. In 2013, the Food and Drug Administration approved Plan B One Step and Next Choice as over-the-counter, available for anyone to ask for. So all you have to do is just go and ask for it. They do have it. You do not require a prescription, okay? All right, and then the last form of contraception I want to talk about is permanent contraception. Permanent contraception also refers to surgical contraception. First, let's look at male sterilization, the vasectomy. It is performed in a physician's office, only takes about 30 minutes, under local anesthesia. Recovery time is a few days to maybe a week. Let's take a look at a video clip outlining what exactly happens in a vasectomy. Looks like we have to wait. Okay, we might have to skip that one. Okay, having some difficulties. So We will go ahead and skip that one, no problem. What I will do with the video clips, if we are not able to see the remaining ones, I'll post them for you on Blackboard so you can take a look and learn a little bit more about that. In addition to vasectomies or male sterilization, there also is a process for sterilization of the female. It is a surgical procedure through the abdomen. It takes also about 30 minutes to complete, but it requires general anesthesia. Here, what you're doing is recovering in the hospital 2 to 4 hours. If there are no problems, then you can, you know, be released home. Where a vasectomy literally cuts the tubules that carry the sperm, in female sterilization, what they're doing is cutting, tying off the fallopian tubes so that the eggs cannot travel from the ovaries into the tubes where they are often fertilized. So that's just a little bit about permanent sterilization. Obviously, permanent means that you've reached a point where you've made a decision you do not want to have children in the future. Yes, surgically they may be able to reconnect all of this, but again, that requires another surgical procedure, not always 100% effective. So this is a decision that is made well after much consideration and lots of discussion with partners, okay? All right, so you've got all of these different types of contraception to consider when you decide to engage in a sexual relationship. So which contraceptive method is going to be best for you? Big question. Each individual must consider the variables on what's most acceptable and appropriate for himself or herself. So some things to consider in all of this are health risks related to the contraceptive method and your own health. The second, the implications of an unplanned pregnancy. Many teens and young adults fail to consider how their life will be affected by an unexpected pregnancy. When considering contraception, think about the consequences of your choice. So sometimes when you are considering contraception and you are younger, you say, I really don't want to think about having children at this point. Then you're going to look for a contraceptive method that is highly effective and that possibly you don't have to deal with very frequently. The other thing you have to consider when you are selecting a contraceptive method is your risk for sexually transmitted diseases. Any kind of intercourse, vaginal, oral, or anal, puts you at risk for a sexually transmitted disease. Condom use is certainly effective, highly effective, at reducing the risk of the transmission of viruses and bacteria that may cause those diseases. When you are in a long-term relationship with someone who has never had sex with anyone other than you, then you can start to consider that safety issue around STDs. The other thing you have to consider with contraception and your choice of method is convenience and comfort. You know, how convenient is it for you to remember to take a pill every day? You know, what is your comfort level with using something like a diaphragm, having a patch on, etc.? The other thing you have to consider in all of this is the type of relationship that you are in. Barrier methods require much more motivation and a sense of responsibility with each partner than do hormonal methods. So if you are in a relationship where there is this commitment and a high level of communication and trust then you may choose to use barrier methods. But certainly hormonal methods you can use because they are really focused on the woman's choice and follow through, so there needs to be little communication cooperation there. The other thing you consider is the ease and cost of obtaining and maintaining any of those birth control methods. If you have insurance, find out what which methods it covers. So that's a consideration, is, you know, how frequently do you have to go to the store to get something, to go to the pharmacy? What is the cost? And then the final consideration is our religious or philosophical beliefs. For some, abstinence and fertility awareness methods may be that only permissible contraceptive method. So you really do have to consider your own belief system. So those are some of the things that you need to consider when deciding which is best for you. And I certainly want to encourage you that you need to be able to talk with your partner about contraception. There needs to be that open communication. And certainly lots of people have a difficult time with this conversation. You know, at what point do you bring it up with your significant other? Whose responsibility is it to make sure that pregnancy and STD risk is diminished? So certainly before talking with your partner, you need to think about your own feelings. You need to pick a good time to bring up the subject, and have that open conversation. Tell your partner how you feel about the different types of contraception, what you both need to do, how you need to commit, and listen to what your partner has to say. Sometimes this takes more than one discussion. And certainly if you want your partner to be involved, and he or she is not interested in that conversation, that's leaving all the responsibility up to you, you really need to question and consider, is this individual really the one I wish to be sexually involved in with? So certainly lots of things to think about. At a minimum, I'm going to highly recommend that you refuse to have sexual activity with anyone who will not use a condom. If you are a woman, please purchase emergency contraception ahead of time, so that you can have it easily available if that condom breaks, if you've forgotten to use your method of contraception. Don't hesitate to use it. And then lastly, if you are engaged in high-risk sexual encounters without using a condom, please consider also getting tested for STDs as soon as possible. Okay, I'm going to move on. I'm going to, again, hold. I have another video to show, but I'm not going to show it during the broadcast today. So I will put this one on as well. It's entitled Meet the Contraceptives, and it's just a quick review of each of those types. So I'll post it on Blackboard for you. What I would like to do is to leave a little bit of time to address another part of this chapter, and that is the issue of abortion. There are very few topics in our culture that are as complex and emotionally charged as abortion is. By definition, abortion means it's the expulsion of an embryo or a fetus from outside the uterus. So there are really two types of abortion. The first is called spontaneous abortion, and that's what's commonly referred to as a miscarriage. A lot of individuals are highly uncomfortable using that term spontaneous abortion because of that emotional charge around the term abortion. So we frequently use miscarriage. We typically refer to anything that is not a spontaneous abortion or miscarriage, which means it's just that embryo, that fetus is expulsed out of the uterus for natural reasons. There's no intervention there. But for anything other than that miscarriage, we do have to consider legal status of abortion in this country. In 1973, the U.S. Supreme Court made abortion legal in the landmark case entitled Roe versus Wade. First trimester abortions are left to the judgment of the pregnant woman and her physician. Similar rights remain up until about the 24th week of gestation. Currently in this country, there's lots of discussion, again, around Roe versus Wade. And there are several states who have redefined access to abortion services. So if you are interested in the issue of abortion in this state, you can certainly find out what is available in California. If you are considering or wanting to know information about other states, you really have to do a state-specific search. There's a great deal of public opinion. Everybody has an opinion about abortion. There is the pro-life position, that is the belief that that fertilized egg has the same rights as any human being. So the pro-life belief system believes that abortion is the equivalent of murder. There is the other position, which is entitled pro-choice. And that is a bit different in that distinctions are made between stages of fetal development and that the woman has the right to decide whether and when to have a child. So pro-choice individuals may say, well, it's okay at this point in pregnancy, but it's not okay here. Or literally, they are saying it is up to the woman to decide what to do with her body. So whether an individual is pro-life or pro-choice, they certainly are entitled to belief systems. Most Americans don't see it as an easy choice. They see these two very different belief systems as very complex. There are no easy answers because, well, is it okay here? Under what conditions would it be okay? So lots of personal considerations to be addressed. There is also a discussion going on just about the man's right regarding abortion. Does the sperm donor, the father, have any say in whether or not the abortion takes place or not? So lots of conversation. I know because it is emotionally charged, sometimes we just don't even want to think about it. But I certainly want to encourage you to look at the issue from both sides. You know, talk with some of those trusted individuals in your life to get some additional input as you develop your own belief system, your own value system. There is a lot of misinformation regarding abortion statistics. So I thought I would share a few of the current statistics with you. Overall, I mean, blanket statement, abortions are fairly common in the U.S. Among American women, in the year 2001, about 45% of all pregnancies were indicated to be unintended. So 45% of all pregnancies are unplanned. About 40% of those unplanned pregnancies end in abortion. So it ends up being about 19% of all pregnancies, whether they're planned or unintended, end in abortion. And that does not include miscarriage. So we're talking about 20% of all pregnancies possibly ending in abortion. And what we've seen over time is very much askew, a strong rise. The chart behind me starts at 1973, when abortions were legalized. About 750,000 abortions took place that year. In 1990, which was our peak year for abortions, was 1.6 million. And then we dropped to 1.2 million in 2001, 2008, 1.06 million in 2011. And the most current information I could find was in 2014, 926,000. So we've definitely seen a drop in abortions. The next visual you're going to see behind me takes a look at when most abortions occur. Whoops. Okay, that one's our trend in abortion. So you can see the rise from 73 to 1990, and then that slow diminishment. Okay, if we could have the next visual. There we go. About two-thirds of abortions occur before the eighth week of pregnancy. About 90% of abortions occur in the first 12 weeks, that first trimester. And so so you can see kind of some of the variation. Different agencies will pair that out by different time frames. But we certainly do know that abortions, again, do occur in this country. A little less than a million in 2014, the most current I could find. Planned Parenthood estimates that about one in three American women will have an abortion by the age of 45. So who is it that has these abortions? In 2014, 12% of all abortion patients were adolescents. About 8% were 18 to 19, about 3% 15 to 17, and and less than 1% were under the age of 15. So about 12% of all abortions are in that adolescent age range. 34% of all abortions are in that age group from age 20 to 24. And then 27% of abortions are in the age group of 25 to 27. And then the remaining amount includes anyone over the age of 27. So again, kind of a broad age span. We find abortions occur among all racial ethnic groups. So again, it is very much at this point an emotional issue, but one that is at this time a legal choice for women to engage in. So let's just take a quick look at what actually happens when you have an abortion. I know lots of us have seen lots of disturbing pictures. So let's take a look at this one and see what actually happens. Last
56
video.
Million abortions occur annually worldwide, and though opinions on the matter are strong, many are simply unaware of how they actually work. So regardless of whether you're pro-life or pro-choice, what actually happens during an abortion? Abortion procedures range from taking a pill to surgical options, often based on availability or how far along a pregnancy is, and 92% of legal US abortions take place within the first 13 weeks of gestation. The oral tablet is effective 49 days from one's last menstrual period. Often containing mifepristone, it works by blocking the hormone progesterone. Progesterone promotes smooth muscle relaxation in the uterine wall throughout pregnancy, and so the pill causes the uterus to contract and the embryo to be expelled in what seems like a heavy period. Vacuum aspiration is a surgical procedure usually used up to 16 weeks after conception and is typically performed under local or general anesthesia. The cervix is numbed and opened wide enough to pass a slender tube into the uterus where suction is used to empty the contents. Within the same timeline, a DNC or dilation and curettage abortion can be used. First, the cervix is dilated using small instruments or medication, and then a curette is used to remove the contents of the uterus. If a pregnancy is between 12 to 24 weeks, a D&E or dilation and evacuation abortion is likely used, although only 1.2% of abortions occur after 21 weeks. In a D&E abortion, the cervix needs to be dilated wider, often using osmotic dilators, which are short rods made of seaweed or synthetic material which absorb moisture and slowly stretch the cervix. These are usually inserted the day before surgery. Once dilated, fetal and placental tissue is removed via vacuum aspiration, forceps, and a curette. The decision to have an abortion after 24 weeks is extremely rare and often due to severe fetal anomalies. When abortions are allowed by the local law, they are one of the safest procedures in medicine, with case fatality rates less than one death per 100,000 procedures. In the US, the risk of death associated with childbirth is 14 times higher in women than that of an abortion. There are also myths that abortion is linked to an increased risk of cancer, as well as difficulties in conceiving or carrying a future pregnancy, but both of these claims have been refuted by extensive medical research. However, unsafe abortions practiced by individuals without the necessary skills or in an environment that does not conform to medical standards cause an estimated 68,000 women to die yearly, while a further 5 million suffer temporary or permanent disability. Methods range from ingesting toxic solutions, inserting foreign bodies into the uterus, and even trauma. The World Health Organization has called unsafe abortions a preventable pandemic. And laws that limit a woman's access to an abortion or make abortions illegal do not reduce the number of abortions. Countries where abortions are illegal have roughly the same number of abortions. What changes instead is the incidence of unsafe abortions. A 2011 study did find that state-level anti-abortion laws in Texas correlated with lower abortion rates in the state, but these results did not account for women traveling to other states with less restrictive laws to receive a procedure. Conversely, researchers have found that sex education and access to contraceptive methods do reduce the number of abortions by minimizing unwanted pregnancies. This can be seen in the abortion rates decreasing significantly in the developed world since 1990. Ultimately, access to legal abortions make women's lives safer and healthier. If you'd like to learn about Plan B or
Okay, so a little bit more information about really what happens in an abortion. Because it is so emotionally charged, sometimes we do hear misinformation being shared. And so these are going to be some of the issues that you're going to hear about in your community, on a national level, on an international level. And do recognize that abortion is not a method of contraception. There are some major considerations women and their partners have to make when they decide to do that. There are complications from abortions, infection, bleeding, some trauma to the cervix or uterus, maybe some cramping, some additional heavier flow in menstruation. But again, as you saw in the video clip, one of the safest medical procedures out there. There is lots of conversation about possible psychological effects. Most of the research indicates that there is neither positive or negative long-term impact on mental health. Responses certainly can vary. They are dependent on the individual, her family, and her support system. Some individuals who have abortions are very relieved. Others feel deep sadness. So there is that gamut of emotions. So for more information on abortions, I strongly encourage you to go to the Centers for Disease Control, cdc.gov. Just type in abortion in the search and you'll get a lot of information. You can also go to guttmacherinstitute.org. Guttmacher Institute has a lot of the statistics, a lot of the trend data on abortions. And then you can also get information from PlannedParenthood.org. So those are some resources. They were all identified for you in the back of your chapter with some others if you really want to pursue that. So with that, we've kind of gone through chapter 6 in the text. We've looked at how contraceptives work, effectiveness, risks, and benefits. We've looked at a variety of the most popular kinds of contraceptives, looking at advantages, disadvantages, and effectiveness. Things to consider when you choose which method is best for you. Then we also looked at the issue of abortion, some of the history, the current legal status, and then a little bit about some of the methods of abortion. So I hope that you have a chance to read and reread chapters 4, 5, and 6. They're all kind of addressing very similar issues, from human sexuality to reproduction and pregnancy to contraception and abortion. You do have a quiz due April 25th, that's next Tuesday, on Chapter 6. That quiz will open up in about an hour, so don't forget to get in there and study for that and then take that. I do have just a quick minute left. I do want to acknowledge that we do have a comment from Alexis. Thanks, Alexis, for your comment. You learned a lot about contraception in family planning and avoiding pregnancy too soon. Jocelyn, I'm glad you were here learning about advantages and disadvantages to contraceptives and effectiveness. Jazz, different types or different ways to prevent sexually transmitted diseases and pregnancy, and having safer sex to help protect yourself. And then Melanie learned that there are both male and female condoms. And you also learned about the cervical cap. So I'm glad each of you were able to pick a few different things from the chapter that you were able to learn. Do keep in mind that while this is session 12, we still have a couple more meetings. Next week at this time, we'll be here looking at immunity and infection. We are going to address some of the sexually transmitted diseases we talked about today. So please read chapter 13 before next Wednesday. Our last broadcast will be May 3rd, and that will be talking about environmental health. So with all of that, we are very close to the end. Hang in there, guys. I want to wish each of you health, peace, and happiness. Have a good week.